Welcome back to Let's Interactively Play Steve Jackson's Sorcery. This is a Let's Play. We get to choose at the end of the video what choice should be made going forward. And the... well... let's just summarize where we are. I think this is one of these seven serpents. Of course, I'm not completely sure. We were traveling with the ferryman now in current day's time. Basically, a plume of thick smoke emerges from beneath his teeth, and yeah, everything except for his clothes disappeared. And then there, all of a sudden, there's a swirling creature overhead. Its gas is choking and noxious. And we try to rifle through a pile of tattered clothing that was left from the, all that was left of the fisherman, or apparently... well, looks like he transformed. We found a shriveled piece of scaly flesh, like a fish skin. The creature declared, "Leave that or I will kill you." You picked up the scale strip and, it's the skin of a snake. The creature screams, "Leave it," and the choking smell is gathering around you more strongly now. So, the majority vote last time was to tear the skin apart, and, we will now do so. Maybe it'll weaken this creature, or we can use it in some manner. Gripping both ends of the snake skin, you snap it apart. A loud cry comes from the serpent, okay? Confirmed serpent, and you look up to see it is separated into two parts. Pretty sure whoever said to tear it would say tear it again, so let's tear it again. Nice! The music's loud. That easy, huh? We did not have to battle this at all. You rip up the halves until there are separate scales, and above you, the serpent has been dispersed. Nothing remains but puffs of smoke which are scattered by the wind. They are soon gone. The boat rocks twice, then falls still. You have now defeated four of the seven serpents. You have dealt with more than half of the deadly serpents. So that's correct. Your math is accurate. You have come into sight of a rocky island. Sweet. So, was this the water serpent? Oh no, the air, the wind or air serpent must have been. Let me just take a look at something. The water serpent is waiting for you. Vulnerable to oil. The time serpent we see, so that's number five. I'm just missing two. I don't think... so if that is the air or wind serpent, then we have water and time, or two more, so that makes six. The air serpent's weakness. Oh, when the air serpent leaves its body as a gas, its body is vulnerable. Got it. Now, he would have been pretty hard to defeat in normal ways because swinging as a gas doesn't really harm. Maybe it's the magic sword. Okay, loud music. Maybe because it was a magic sword, it could have damaged it anyway, but we did not even have to fight this thing. Okay, 4 out of 7 done, and this is... well, we want to go here. We've been here, so let's go this way. You row the boat onwards across the water. The sun is dropping down to the west. Soon it will be dark. You pull on the oars, sliding forwards through the water. So a lot easier... I want to go here. You don't understand. Maybe from the boat we can step on, maybe swimming. It was too hard to climb aboard. I'll climb ashore. You rowed the boat onwards across the water. The sun is now in the lowest quarter of the sky. Every stroke is hard through the strange thick water. Still trying to get closer to this island. You row the boat onwards across the water. Night falls. You should find somewhere safe to sleep, especially after so much rowing on an empty stomach. The oar draws whirls and ripples in the surface of the lake with every stroke. Well, if I could rest in the tower, that'd be perfect. We can go ashore? Seriously? You row the boat onwards across the water. The moon is climbing the sky. You heave on the oars, gliding onwards. The motion is calm and relaxing, but you seem to move no faster than a crawl, however hard you work. The stars in the water ripple and shift, forming strange patterns. You've come within reach of a low island. Nice. We did it, guys. You row the boat onwards across the water and then pull it up to the shore. The first few stars appear. The dark is treacherous. You would do well to sleep here. Yeah, I guess we can. Laying your pack down on the shore of the lake, you try to settle despite the strange noises that float across the landscape. You have not yet eaten today. So, yeah, I know it looks rather small. But the, as you guys have noticed, the character model we have here is not to scale with the environment, so this may be an extremely thick and hard to cross forest. Might take a little more than two steps to get there. So let's eat something. Yes, we are full again. You eat an apple, feeling much better for it. Then you stretch out and rest. The remainder of the night is filled with vivid dreams. A snake rears up from out of a well shaft, its body filling the opening, and it grows wider, and it grows and grows until it is a... Why is it wider? It grows and grows until it is a tower. Then it opens its mouth, emitting light. Mocking laughter seems to ring in your ears. Strange dreams. Day 27. An island. During the past day, you used one provision and some gold, four, and defeated the air serpent. Meaning there are three still out there. The sun rises above the waters of the lake. The island is covered in a dense tree cover. The top of a stone tower is just visible above the canopy. In it, the shadow stands a bell, pulled up in the shallows as your rowboat. Well, we're going to explore. We don't need the bell. What the hell would it do? There would be no response to the bell. Plus, we have the boat. You move away into the thick woods that cover the island. You know, who needs a ferryman that turns into a gaseous snake to send the boat? We were the ones rowing anyway. It was two steps inland. So funny. The path winds along the shoreline, skirting an area of dense trees. Then it ducks below the canopy, and you are surrounded by the calling of strange creatures. Insects and birds buzz past your face. From the shore, you saw a stone tower sticking up between the trees that fill the island's heart, but now you cannot see the way forward, and the path seemed to twist and turn about. Let's check out our spells. I'm not returning to the shore. We must find this tower. Alright, find safe passage. It seems like a good idea. This is hover in the air. You would have to hover quite high to get above all those trees. Suppose it could be done. Wait. See the future. Interesting, but another floating air spell. Read minds. There's no one here who has a mind to read. As far as I know, anyway. Alright, let's find safe passage. Looking to the stars, you craft the magic, and a quiet voice begins to speak to you. The voice indicates a thin path that will lead to this island's tower. With that, the spell fades. A flock of nearby birds startle at something, lifting suddenly into the trees. Okay. Yeah, we will follow the narrow track. Of course, there's something nearby because it's scaring the birds. But I don't know. Trusting to your spell, you follow the narrow track between the trees. After a few minutes of walking, you come within sight of the base of a stone tower. It is heavily overgrown. The door to the tower stands open. Gnarled roots and vines have forced it open and are now holding it ajar. The inside of the tower is dank and filled with mud, as though it has been flooded and emptied several times. Probably has, then. Stone stairs curve up to a hatch in the roof. You cast an eye over the walls, which are covered floor to ceiling with intricate carvings. Suddenly, something lights up in one dark corner. A flame. A flame. There's someone lighting a cigarette? Look at the flame. The flame seems to hover a short way off the ground. As you watch, it swells inside from a single thumb to a fireball size of a small dish. Who are we gonna call out to? Let's look for shelter, I guess. You look around quickly for somewhere to shelter, but apart from the staircase that runs up the tower, there are no walls, no furniture, and no cover of any kind. The fire has grown now to a full fireball of clearly magical nature, and in its light you can see what is holding it. It is a rough wooden frame of sticks shaped into the form of a woman with arms spread wide. It is a grimalkin, if I'm saying that right. Like the crown of kings itself is. What the sightmaster told you is true. Okay, so maybe it's not malicious. Maybe we'll wait and watch. I'm not going to run. We worked so hard to get to this tower. Let's wait and watch. If we're going to fight it, well, we're going to fight it when it attacks. You wait and watch. A fireball, hot and fierce, shoots forward from the wooden frame towards you. Dodge right? Just guessing. You dodge right and the fireball punches past you, not aiming at the door, but instead splashing up the staircase that leads up the tower. The room is dark for a moment. Splashing up the staircase? Hope she's not destroying the instrument. Up top, I'd rather not. I'd rather look at both if we can. Why don't we want to see what this grimalkin is doing? In the pause between fireballs and darkness, you see a little of the grimalkin. The frame is built from old, half-rotten wood, beams that were once perhaps part of a roof. A single upright forms the body and head. Its two arms are angled outwards to collect starlight. It has clearly been positioned beneath the stars of Hait, Osiris, and Thara, and angled so the resulting fireball is directed at the staircase. A new fireball begins to form between the arms of the grimalkin. Don't think we should wait. Let's see if we can cast a spell. Well, that's not going to help. That's hovering in air. Counters a zap. Well, that's lightning bolts, not fire. I'm supposed we want to cast a counterspell, but I don't think we know a counterspell for fireball. I'm trying to click on the A here. Talk with animals. I don't think it's an animal. I don't have a pearl ring. A so it's not aiming at me, it's aiming up the staircase. Which means we have to get rid of this thing before we go up the staircase. Open locks and doors. Why? Cause slowness. That's an idea. We'll make the fireballs appear much slower. Create an invisible wall. I like that idea. If we can position it between the fireball and the staircase. Yeah, I don't... Oh, wait. That's the end of a spell? Heal disease. That's weird, though. Wait. That was weird. Heal disease is a lowercase d. What about the uppercase? Oh. Wait. Didn't I click on D? D. Oh, that's that. Okay. Alright. Let's use the force field here. Seems like a good invisible wall. You spin the starlight into a pattern around you, throwing up an invisible barrier in front of you. The wall cuts the tower in two and should protect you from the Grimalkin's fireballs. A new one is currently forming. Well, let's wait and watch and make sure the force field is able to protect us. You watch as the fireball forms and is released. It strikes the invisible wall with a tremendous force, and then bounces back in a wash of fire that surrounds the Grimalkin. The dry, aged wood is quickly incinerated. With the Grimalkin destroyed, the tower falls quiet. Once more, you notice the carvings on the wall, forgotten in your battling with the Grimalkin. Cool. That worked. Look at the carvings. The carvings are beautifully preserved, unlike in all the other towers you've climbed. They cover the walls from floor to roof, telling a story in sequence. The first panels show the construction of a great city on the shores of a lake by a powerful and proud people. Think we know what that is. Then the city is threatened by a series of avalanches and other disasters, attributed to an underground demon. Several buildings are destroyed. So this is the fate of the port city north of here? Read more carvings. You climb a little way up the stairs to pick up the story of the carvings. The destroyed buildings are rebuilt, but a council of wise men and women are gathered to discuss the problem. They scratch their beards and comb their hair and rub their eyes in thought, and finally they set to building a series of great towers scattered around the land. The purpose of the towers is not clear, however, but all seem convinced they will save the city from further disaster. They celebrate with raised arms. Okay. So is it really the people from this city, which we recently visited? I mean, it could, it might not be the same city that they built the towers. The purpose of the towers is not clear, however, but all seem convinced they will save the city from further disaster. Let's finish reading the carvings. The final panels of the carvings show a man in a horned helmet delivering some kind of equipment to the builders of the stone towers. From the symbols of this man's cloak, you realize he is supposed to be one of the archmages of High Zaman. Each tower is fitted with a lantern, and the lanterns are lit. Birds freeze in midair, rivers cease. In the light of the lantern, clouds stop their scudding across the sky. Is that what clouds do up there? Scudder? Scudder around? Below the level of the towers, the land is peaceful and people are happy. It seems the light will keep them safe, and that is the end of the story. From here you could go up the tower or back out into the trees. Okay. Well, if it is this city to the north, in other words, you guys know I'm talking about this city, it did not save them after all. You make your way up the steps of the tower and open the hatch in the ceiling. Once again, the tower is topped with a movable cylinder and a blue crystal. Look at the view. From here, you can see across the island to the water that surrounds it. More interesting is the shoreline further south, where the ruins of two statues are just visible atop a broken landing stage. It must have been a grand harbor once. For a moment you seem to see a great winged creature lift itself up from the waters of the lake, but a moment later it has gone. Right, okay, the shoreline further south. We're talking about this. We've been over here, we just didn't climb ashore. I decided not to pursue it because we have business to attend to here, because I'm pretty sure this leads to the end of the chapter, and it'll be into chapter 4. So naturally I want to find all the serpents I can before we finish this. Activate the beacon. This tower seems to be broken. You are forced to give it a kick before the beam begins to shine. That's all we had to do it? Like, that's all we had to do, like the Fonz? Adjust the beam. Okay. So there's the time serpent. We saw a great winged creature lift itself up from the shores of the lake, so could be the time serpent or the water serpent. Well, there's one thing we can do. It'd be a lot easier to climb aboard. Or climb ashore. I keep saying aboard. In an earlier time. And of course we'll pass out of the beam and be back to our present time. Wondering though if this will have some effect on the serpent. Because it is a time serpent. It seems incredible that anyone should have built these towers with their curious lanterns. Indeed, you cannot help but wonder what these towers did originally. What appeared in the land beneath the beam when the land was everywhere lush and green? When the light touches you, you feel suddenly much better. Okay, we're back to full stamina. Yeah, back in the past when they had these towers, what would appear in the beam? The present? Or back further in the past? You consider the carvings as you regard the light. What is it these beacons truly do? They do not hold back the clouds or stop the rivers flowing. You have walked through their beams and seen night turn to day and back again. Perhaps the purpose of the towers has changed since they were built. But why? What purpose do they serve? Except, it would seem, to assist you in your journey. That's a good question. You touch the blue crystal and begin to rise upwards. Oh, we've been to all these towers. You descend downwards. You find yourself on top of a tower that looks out over a thick forest. The brass cylinder rests on its bearing track. All right, let's climb down, I guess. You return to the base of the tower. You return to the floor of the tower. From here, you could go back up the tower or back out into the trees. Let's go back into the trees. And you step out into the forest once more and return to the shore. You return to the shore of the lake. The bell sparkles in the sunshine. The little boat is still here. It's curious. You haul the rope of the bell. Nothing happens. No kidding. You push the boat out into the water of the lake and hop aboard. The craft looks well built and freshly oiled. You should make excellent time. You row the boat onwards across the water. As the morning moves on, the wind begins to rise. Every pull on the oars is tiring. Alright, I guess we've really explored so much. I don't know what else we need to do except fight at least two more serpents. I have no idea where the other one could be. But the water, you would think, would be in this lake as well. You row the boat onwards across the water. As the sun climbs toward its zenith, the winds pick up. You sing a song from your girlhood as you draw on the oars. A song of fruit trees and warm milk and soft bedding. The water falls strangely calm. Rowing becomes easier and you cut quickly through the water. You'll be across the lake in no time. So it's no longer as thick here? You notice a thin stream of bubbles off to the port side. Now, we've seen this before, and I tried to investigate. Nothing happened. I didn't see anything. Cast a spell. Wait, why am I in backwards order? Okay. That's a fireball. Create light. This is, sense danger. Invisibility. Fireball. Create wind. I don't know what use any of this stuff would be. Alright, what if we avoid the bubbles? Oh my! Oh my god! Shaggy, I have no I had no idea. I knew it would be here in the water. That would make sense, but seriously, I was just wondering about it. And here it is. You turn the boat and row away from the rising bubbles, but you are not fast enough to escape. Breaking through the surface of the water is a long, thin shape. It rises to one side of the boat in a coil and then unfolds two dripping, leathery wings. You half smile with pleasure at the encounter. It is the water serpent. We need oil. We have oil. So, draw my sword or cast a spell. What about the oil? I swear, I just looked at this. Oil. Flask of oil. So we have the oil. Maybe a spell involving oil? Or maybe during the battle I'll have an option to throw the oil. I'm not sure. Let's see if there's any spells that require oil. Well, this is going to be fireball. Turn to stone. Talk all languages. What if we try talking to this? Cause depression? Oh, requires a serpent ring, which you do not have. Huh. All this time, again, I've been wondering in the back of my mind if we could talk to one of the serpents. Figured this would be a good time to do so, but no, we need a serpent ring as well as a spell. Crap. Unknown. Well, I don't think this is a good time to be experimenting. That's, lightning. Exploding pebbles. Wait. Alright, I don't really know. I want to use the oil is what I want to do. So I guess draw my sword. Okay, good, we have options. You draw your long sword from its scabbard and shout a challenge at the beast. The water serpent is now free of the water and hovers, a massive shape against the dark sky. It stretches open its wide jaws. Throw something into the creature's mouth. You look in your pack for something you could use as a missile. Throw the flask of oil. Throw my... Yeah, that would be a great idea. Throw my sword. Hmm. The goblet of lynch bug oil. I have lynch bug oil, too? And flask of oil? Seriously? Waiting for the music to subside. You toss the flask of oil into the mouth of the creature, and then watch in amazement as it takes effect. In mere moments, the serpent breaks into splashes of water, which rain down across the surface of the lake. The water falls quiet once more. You have now defeated 5 of the 7 serpents. Time to resume your journey. Only 2 more serpents remain at large. Well, we know where one of them are. Well, I can't go straight there. Yeah, I guess I'll head for this serpent. I mean, this would be a good time to stop it as far as just time increments, but there's nothing to choose. All that's left, really, is to fight this time serpent. You row the boat onwards across the water. The mid-afternoon heat fills the landscape. You lean on the oars, moving slowly forward across the lake. You've never rowed so far, or for so long. In the fields of Charberry, where you grew up, there was no open water beyond a few ponds. Interesting. There was no open water. Nothing to douse the approaching flames. What is this? What is this? Nothing to douse the approaching... Am I, like, daydreaming or something? It does no good to think of it, I guess. The other one seems like it's asking for trouble. You turn your thoughts away from home. It does no good to think of it, and you will most likely never see it again. You keep your eyes fixed on the distant shore and pull for all your are worth. Alright, let's head for the... Yeah, the island. You row the boat onwards across the water. Heat beats down from a cloudless sky. Every stroke is hard work, but you are making progress. You have come into sight of a small island. You row the boat across the water and then pull it up onto the shore. The sun is beginning to lower. The air begins to cool. The island is nothing but piled boulders and rubble. Close to the shoreline is a bell. Your small boat bobs in the shadows. Exploring inland, you clamber up the rocks to the middle of the small island. Doom awaits. For some reason I feel like this dragon is going to be tough. We do not know the weakness of this one. You head away from the shoreline up the rocky slope of the island. Low shrubs grow from the cracks between large stones. The wind drops. Even the water below seems to stand still. This island is quiet, deathly quiet, as though nothing here was alive at all. The air seems to shimmer slightly, It is as though you can see the beacon's beam here, in this one place, in the whole of the Backlands. Look ahead. You creep a little up a stony embankment and try to peer at what is ahead. You make out a bowl-shaped depression in the ground, some kind of pit. At the base lies something, a coiled shadow, but you cannot make out what it is without going closer. You return to the path, thoroughly alarmed. Well, duh, it's the serpent. Well, I was almost kind of happy to see the other serpent. Keep climbing. That didn't take away stamina. You continue climbing up the strange dead slope. The path turns and then descends into, guess what? A bowl-shaped pit. Penultimate serpent here. You crest the edge of the rocky pit and look down. The coiled shape you saw earlier is still there, curled up, apparently asleep. Well, seems silly to turn back. I could creep up on it or cast a spell. I just wanted to peek at what the spells were, but... Eh? You begin to cast a spell, spreading your arms wide. But of course you only have one arm. The other was lost on the climb up the hill... What? The other was lost on the climb up the hill, don't you remember? What? I did not lose an arm climbing up the hill. The dark shape uncoils, turning its vast jaw toward you with what is clearly a smile. Okay, not sure. I guess I'm gonna leave it here. For votes, stay still. Maybe if we wait, we'll have more options. I'm assuming reaching for my sword will just go right into combat, although, as we've seen, this very episode doesn't always happen that way. So I'm more like trying to anticipate what will happen at this point for choosing either option. So what do you think I should do, guys? Should I stay still? Wait to see what happens? We know it knows we're there. Or should I just reach for my sword and go for broke? Thanks for watching, guys. See you in the next episode. And, yeah, thanks for voting and everything. Thanks for watching. Endure, and enduring, grow strong. See you next week.